as we land from our discussion on aviation, we now move to a more earthly subject, the future of healthcare. A topic that deserves no less attention, given that for the world's population to enjoy a cleaner environment, they first need to be healthy. Currently, half of the world's population does not have access to essential health services. Another 800 million spend at least 10% of their household budgets on health expenses, with 1 in 8 are driven into extreme poverty by these costs. To make matters worse, a growing population across the world is putting pressure on an already weak infrastructure. If the COVID crisis has proven one thing, it's that the world needs more doctors, more nurses, and better medical facilities to accommodate an ever-rising demand for healthcare. With a limited capacity for the world to graduate more medical staff, the attention turns to the leaders of the industry and an expectations to innovate in the field of pharma, biotech, and medical engineering. With the advance in AI and machine learning, a new science emerges to help drive more efficiencies in medicine and the application through modern technology to scale the healthcare industry towards a more personalized approach in diagnosis and treatment, or what is known as precision health. Which roadmap should we follow to reach that point? How can we build a sustainable healthcare system? What innovations will we see in this field, and how will the hospital of the future look like? These are all questions that I'm going to put across to our panel. I'm joined today, of course, by healthcare expert André Daoud, whose latest role was the CEO of Medcare Hospitals and Medical Centers, and Mahir Rafi'i, Head of Strategy Marketing at GE Healthcare EMEA. André, I will begin with you. Can you help us understand more what is sustainability when it comes to the healthcare system, and what are the main pillars needed in building such a system?
Good morning, everyone, and it's a real honor to be here with you. Basically, the word sustainability has gone way and beyond nowadays. And I think you've tapped into a couple of words that were key, and one of them is capacity. And definitely, COVID has been a massive experience for everyone. Now, disruption is happening in every industry, and healthcare is no different to that. And fintech companies are also becoming healthcare providers before even healthcare providers in the market are even, I wouldn't say digitalizing themselves, adopting a system. So the landscape is quite challenging, and there's a lot of disruption happening. But if you want to continue to build on the brick and mortar model and continue to say, I need more hospital, more beds, more doctors, this is not sustainable in my humble opinion. And I think one of the key strategies going forward has to be go-to-home strategy. So how do I treat people where they are? Because in a hospital, you can put 100, 200, 300, 400 beds, but you have millions of houses around the world and in every city. So how can I provide care at their home? And I think that is where the world is shifting, with machinery and inventions that are happening, whereby historically probably you couldn't move an X-ray, you needed two trucks to bring in an X-ray. Now you have portable X-rays and so on. So how can we be at home and reduce the requirement and the need for people to mobilize themselves and come to a healthcare facility? That will create a more sustainable model. I'll give a couple of examples. So historically, people needed to come and do their blood test at home. Mm-hmm. And now there are devices where people check themselves. And that's basic, I'm saying, in the basic of healthcare.
The hospitals?
They used to come to the hospital to get their tests done. Now, when we look, for example, in Silicon Valley, there was a company who was developing a vest that women can wear, which has sensors around the breast. So instead of women having to go have a mammogram, probably in the future, they wear the vest and it measures every week the temperature movement in the breast and will detect any potential risks. Blood sugar can be measured from a lens in the eye. So the way things are moving today is how do we go to the patient rather than bring the patient in, including technology, as you said, AI and all that, but also be creative rather than just continue to think, okay, let's hire more doctor. Not that we don't need them, but that would not be enough to create the healthcare sustainability.
We'll go back to the technological aspect, but let me hear Mohi's opinion here. What are your thoughts? What's the way forward in building such a sustainable healthcare system? And what kind of partnership is needed in the process?
Look, I agree with what Andreas said. I think, you know, the word resilience is really important in healthcare. So as we build a sustainable healthcare system, how do we make it more resilient? And I think COVID has shown us the need for resilience in healthcare over the last couple of years. Part of that, I think, as we think about sustainability in the future, is keeping in mind our focus on making healthcare definitely a person-centric approach. You know, putting the patients and the caregivers first and foremost at the heart of design, which is really important. And, you know, Andres, and you spoke about it, there is a shortage of nurses, there is a shortage of doctors and technicians around the world.
I think the number is 18 million, if I'm not mistaken.
And so the current healthcare workers and frontliners are overburdened and overworked. And so we need to find solutions and innovations that come to market that help remove a lot of the administration and redundancies that they're doing today, freeing their time up, so we can automate a lot of that, use technology and innovation to automate a lot of that workflow so that they can spend more time with the patients, which is really where their focus should be. The other aspect of innovation and making systems more sustainable, especially resilient, is how we ingest data. And I think we'll talk more about that in a bit. But to give you just a conceptual perspective of that, a hospital generates about 50 petabytes of data annually. And what that means, in essence, is, for example, 1 petabyte equals about 1 million gigabytes. So hospitals today are very data rich, but the problem is they're also insights poor. And so how do we unlock intelligence in that data in a coordinated way that allows caregivers to really take timely and informed decisions at the point of care when it matters most? That will help drive efficiencies, as we'll talk in a bit, as well as how make the system more resilient. Also, the economics of healthcare is tough. You know, the burden of cost for governments, but also from the private sector to treat and pay for care as we move forward is high. And so how do we think about the economics and re-innovate financial models with our caregivers to think about how they procure innovation? You know, how do they look at innovation and procure it, and how do we focus what we do together on outcomes that really deliver value, whether they're clinical outcomes, whether they're operational outcomes, and definitely whether they're financial outcomes.
So Andre, Mohi mentioned something that is important, and that is efficiency. And the efficiency is definitely a pillar when it comes to sustainability. It's estimated around 20% of what is spent on healthcare is wasted. So my question here, how can we increase efficiency in order to enhance access to medical service and improve outcomes?
Sure, and there are different pillars to address that. Definitely, it's not a one-stop shop or an off-the-shelf solution. And 20%, I think, is a conservative number. I think there's a lot more to be saved. When you look at healthcare, at least from our perspective, we were looking at it from clinical excellence and patient safety being the first pillar. And we don't compromise on patient health. The second aspect was the patient journey. And that's the important pillar whereby it could answer the question, because the idea was to have a unique, seamless, digital patient journey whereby we free the people from administrative burden and we let them focus on the clinical aspect and offering empathy and attention to patients. I believe all of us have been to healthcare providers, have visited a provider. You will see the nurse is busy with her head down, writing, entering data, and so on. And that's way, way beyond the 20%. The machinery is one aspect, but also the digitalization of the process. And digitalization is not just bringing in a system and I have that system here. It's about smart systems. It's about workflows. It's about the entire patient journey. And how can I be also proactive? And where does the patient journey start? So I've been asking in multiple forums, where does the patient journey start? And many people say in the valet parking or when I come into the reception. And the reality, no. It starts when every individual feels they need healthcare. This is where the healthcare provider has to be, through omni-channels, different access, and so on.
I would have thought when they called to take an appointment.
No, even before. So, because we have to be there, right? So So when you have the need, you need to call and have an appointment. How can I offer you a seamless experience in booking an appointment or driving you to the right doctor and the right clinical care that you require, rather than having, okay, I call a doctor, then I need to ask questions, I need to be asked questions. So I think it's the entire patient journey that needs to be revamped, honestly. And there are today massive data that not everybody's looking at, and some people do look at it, and I'm talking about our industry, and probably they don't understand the value they can extract from it. And the data speaks numbers, but also speaks facts, and is a good guide and a good compass for healthcare providers to be able to address those matters. And once you have clean and good data, you have to plug in the AI, which will then start predicting in terms of people's behavior, patient behavior. So if they see you trending in a certain way, and then the AI detects that you've missed on that, then there is now a proactive approach from the healthcare provider for preventative care. And also, this will help drive more from only a clinical aspect now, which is currently the trend, to functional and clinical, which is a 360 wellness approach. And you have to work on the prevention, you also have to work on the maintenance and the treatment. All those three together will provide a healthier pool and reduce the burden from the healthcare system as it evolves in other things as well.
In your opinion, what is the percentage of data that is being used compared to the
minimal,
data?
Minimal, I would say.
Less than 5%, less than single digit.
Yeah, I would say in the single digits or early double digits, but there's massive potential behind it. And it's not being optimized and used to the max.
Before we explore more the data, and I know GE is betting big on technologies, I just want your opinion on how to create a more efficient, cost-effective healthcare system.
Yeah, as I spoke earlier, I think, as Andre highlighted, efficiency is really important. But I'd like to rephrase efficiency. It's not just about creating efficient healthcare systems. It's really about creating intelligently efficient healthcare systems. So how do we do that? How do we unlock and create resilient and intelligently efficient healthcare systems as we move forward? Well, data is going to be a big part of it. So today, the data that we talked about earlier sits in different departments and hospitals. Yeah, it's not connected. And so the problem is, as we talk about how much of that data is utilized, is caregivers don't have access to a holistic view of the patient in a simple, easy to access and utilize manner. And that's a real challenge. So how do we unlock that? Well, in GE, one of the things we're doing is we've created our Edison Intelligence Platform, which is a layer of software that sits on top of all the disparate data sources within hospitals, pulling from the electronic medical records, pulling from business intelligence records, pulling from laboratory records, et cetera, ingesting that data. And what this does is it helps then aggregate that data and curate it and structure it. And then, as Andre mentioned, pull on the right AI and algorithms based on the use cases you want to use, and then orchestrate that data in a fashion that you can then go back and embed it and provide it to the caregivers and their fingertips at the point of care. So let me give you a couple examples of how we do that. One which I'm sure you've all experienced at some point in your life, if not, you know someone who has, which is an x-ray. Yeah, we've all done an x-ray at some point. Imagine a scenario where you walk into an emergency department and you have a suspected pneumothorax or a collapsed lung. Today, you take an x-ray, you do that x-ray, you need to send it through the department to a central reading port so the radiologist or caregiver can look at it. It's in a queue and isn't really necessarily prioritized, so there's time delay in terms of intervention. What we're doing now is we're using AI and building that AI and algorithm into the device at the point of care in the x-ray machine. So now when you take the x-ray, the AI can quickly detect an anomaly in that x-ray, potentially preferentially diagnose, saying, hey, this looks like a collapsed lung, and then it will prioritize that to the top of the queue, allowing caregivers to quickly identify it and intervene. That's just one example.
But also when you send it to the lab, they can also misdiagnose, and the individual can also read it differently. So with that, you minimize the chances of misdiagnosis as well. Mm-hmm. And this is not, 100%. This is reality. This is not sci-fi. Huh? This is actually feasible and happening. Sorry.
No, you're absolutely right. And you know, when you look at efficiencies as well, it's how do you improve workflow and patient flow for hospitals to drive better productivity and obviously better outcomes, not only for patients, but also operational-wise as well as financial-wise. Another great example, MRIs. I don't know how many of you have taken an MRI, but for many people, that experience is can be seen to be quite claustrophobic, sitting inside the tube.
Absolutely.
But also, to get the way the MRI works, to get sharp images that allow radiologists and caregivers to diagnose, they may have to spend up to 30, 40 minutes for some scans in the MRI. Today, we've brought technology in using AI and algorithms, technologies such as our AIR Recon DL, which allows us to use AI embedded into the MRI. Two things happen. First, it reduces scan time from 30, 40 minutes to about 7 to 10 minutes, which is really important. Why is that valuable? Well, for hospitals that are looking to drive productivity and efficiency in their systems, they can reduce wait times and bring more patients through as such. For the patient, it's a much better and pleasant experience. You don't have that long time sitting in the MRI. But also, what we don't compromise in that process is quality, the quality of the image. If anything, we actually enhance it because the way AI learns from the raw data, it's able to provide a sharper image for the caregivers to do a more precise diagnosis. There's also opportunities at an enterprise level. If you think about how hospitals run, you mentioned there's a lot of waste potentially in healthcare systems. We have clinical command centers in place around the world today that look at ingesting millions of data sets and millions of data points from multiple sources into a central command center. We see command centers in use in aviation, in the air traffic control, and how they coordinate traffic flights and so on. That's now in hospitals today, and that's in real time. So we're moving from a situation where caregivers are having to think about what happened and then come up with a solution to getting real-time information available to them for all operations of the hospital and then being able to take action and prevent problems that may occur in the future, as well as understand capacity needs and other opportunities for operational efficiencies as we move forward. So those are just a few examples.
So how can these technologies translate into what the future of a hospital would look like?
Exactly. And on the command center point, let's start talking about smart cities then.
Yep.
And how do we provide care beyond the hospital walls and boundaries? And those command centers and those machineries and those devices and those technologies are the path. And this is where the focus has to shift. I believe a lot of the focus now is happening on the day-to-day, when in parallel also there is focus that is happening on how do we move in this direction? How do we provide care outside the boundaries of the hospital? And even with improved results, and as you said, there are scarce resources today. If you have the command center, I can maximize the use of resources to access a far bigger pool of people rather than having a doctor for 3-4 patients in one hospital, another doctor there, whose time is not full in monitoring patients. Now, if I have a number of patients and a centralized function with all the skills sitting there, then I am increasing more or creating more efficiency in the system and being able to cater to more people at lesser cost. And this is where sustainability comes from as well.
Mohi, you're talking here about personalized, seamless, automated healthcare. We are going to reach that point. But when exactly, how far are we from reaching this new world?
That's a $64 million question, isn't it? I mean, the reality is the promise of precision medicine and personalized healthcare is an exciting one. And, today, if you think about healthcare and how we tackle disease, it's very much a one size fits all. But what's very clear is that we're not all fitting to that one size. Yeah? And so we need to think about a future where it's tailored to the individual. Your biology, my biology, Andre's biology is very different. Yeah? And so when we think about scenarios, take cancer, for example. When we think about scenarios where we have a cancer diagnosed in one individual and the same cancer exists in another individual, today we treat both those individuals in exactly the same way. Chemotherapy is the standard treatment course. There's costs involved with chemotherapy, which are quite high. There's also a lot of adverse effects that we know through the treatment journey of cancer. Unfortunately, the outcomes are not the same for everyone. Not everyone enjoys the same positive outcomes as a result of that treatment. Why is that? That's because, in essence, our biologies are different. Our genetic makeup is different. And taking that genetic makeup and that understanding of our genes into consideration as one of the key variables, amongst other things, our family history, our environmental exposure, everything else that takes in place, and ingesting that data to really understand us as humans at an individual level allows us to make much more informed and personalized decisions, not only on our treatment, but as Andre says, where healthcare is going in the future is beyond the hospital into the prevention and wellness space. Imagine a scenario in the future where we are all connected in real time to our health data. Wouldn't that be exciting? You know, we get into a car every day and we see our dashboard and we see the health of our car and we take proactive steps to ensure our car remains healthy. But every day we wake up and we don't have that same engagement of our own health data in real time. And when that happens through wearables and other devices that are coming down the line, that's really gonna unlock the potential of true precision health. And we're gonna be empowered citizens that are really gonna be taking a proactive step in managing our own health. And you know what's gonna happen to hospitals? They're gonna become truly specialized centers of intervention. So the burden is gonna move away where it sits today and the cost is gonna move away where it sits today. And we're gonna be moving to a much more citizen-empowered population health environment of the future.
Obviously, precision health is unlocking a lot of opportunities in the healthcare system. However, there are challenges in applying that, and especially in regards to routine clinical care. Where do you see these challenges? Is it about data privacy or what? Data sharing?
I believe there is a regulatory landscape today and governance around the data aspect. And I don't see that as a concern, and we're becoming more an open source population. So basically how you leverage that data probably is a challenge today, because knowingly or unknowingly, a lot of us have data recorded in a certain cloud somewhere when we accept agreements.
But these are very sensitive data.
Agreed.
DNA data and...
Agreed. I fully agree with you. Now, let me go one step back to Mahi's point in terms of the cancer. There was a company also in Silicon Valley that I looked at a couple of years back or 3 years back. They were building a global database of cancer. And the reason being exactly to your point was, okay, if you have a male at the age of 45, this type of cancer, you follow the same protocol, it doesn't lead to the same results. And the idea was, how much can you map in criterias between the individual and the treatment? And you need to narrow down to the maximum you can, where you find a better match. Someone who is 45 with diabetes is not the same without diabetes to be treated for cancer. So, but you will need access to that data. And I think for, I would say, the well-being of the population, and as we go forward, it is key to make sure this data is accessible for the right reasons and the good causes. I heard the earlier session, they were talking about nuclear energy, which was a taboo. Now we're competing who has a nuclear reactor that can use it, right? So tomorrow we should move into the space where we capitalize on the trillions of data bytes that are available and be able to extract the best data, map it, and make sure that we offer quality care, or the system is able to offer quality care with best outcome.
Thank you so much. One last question. How much do you think COVID accelerated those technological innovations?
It's had a huge impact. You know, the digitization of healthcare for a long period of time tended to sit within the IT departments. And it was always a challenge to bring that to the forefront of the C-suite to really make investments in a proactive manner. And what COVID showed us is digitization of healthcare isn't an IT issue, it's a clinical issue, it's an enterprise issue, and needs to be at the forefront of strategy today and into the future. COVID adoption from a consumer perspective, we saw, you know, a lot of technologies from virtual, using mobile phones to consult virtually with doctors, telemedicine. There's a lot of innovation that came through. And the conversation around how we continue to integrate data and digitize data has been accelerated. And I think there's real investments happening globally to ensure that we're more ready for the future than we were today. But at the same time, you mentioned partnerships earlier. I think that's really important to create a sustainable, efficient, and intelligently efficient healthcare ecosystem as we move forward requires an ecosystem of partners. And what we're seeing as we move forward today is, you know, GE is really at the center of an ecosystem, bringing in partners, which are either smart, small developers, startups, or even working with our caregivers globally to really create this ecosystem of healthcare that can be resilient, leveraging data and AI effectively, and hopefully delivering better patient outcomes for all of us, and our families, and our friends, and our communities, wherever we may be.
Thank you so much. I guess if we want to conclude, we may say that it's good to take things personal when it comes to in creating a sustainable healthcare system. Thank you so much for your valuable insights, and hope you enjoyed this
session. Appreciate it.
Thank you.